Good morning. A new Premier yesterday, a new Deputy Premier today. New South Wales is officially under fresh leadership. But all eyes were on Gladys Berejiklian this morning, who stepped out in public for the first time since her shock resignation on Friday. State politics reporter Liz Daniels is at New South Wales Parliament House for us this morning. Liz, the former Premier had some kind words for her replacement, Dominic Perrottet.
Lizzie, she did. She was urging everyone to support Mr. Perrottet in taking over the leadership. Of course, she's been laying low for 5 days since her shock resignation on Friday, as she was named as being under investigation by the corruption watchdog. Now, Gladys Berejiklian obviously feels like she's now had enough time to digest that information and digest that, I guess, sadness that she was feeling on Friday. And she has come out today to thank everyone who's been leaving beautiful flowers and notes, poems and messages of support, both at her electorate office and at her home. Have a listen to what Gladys Berejiklian had to say today.
I just want to say again a big thank you to everybody. It's been enormous comfort to know people care, and I want the community to get behind Premier Perrottet, as I know they will. He will be an outstanding leader, and at this important time we need everybody to follow the Premier's words and make sure that we come out of this lockdown as safely as possible.
And Liz, the Nationals have also decided on John Barilaro's replacement this morning.
Yeah, that's right. So John Barilaro addressed the party room, the Nationals party room this morning in a lengthy speech that he had, and I'm told he was quite emotional in his farewell to his colleagues. Now, he decided to resign on Monday following the Premier's resignation, saying that there needed to be renewal. The Nationals, in that lengthy meeting, have replaced John Barilaro as leader. It was Paul Toole, the former deputy, who will now take over as the leader of the National Party. He then becomes also the deputy premier. Bronnie Taylor, who's the Minister for Women, was elected as his deputy. So she now becomes the most senior woman in the Perrottet-Toole government. And that is the new team. Dominic Perrottet, the premier. Paul Toole, the deputy. And that, Lizzie, is likely to be a bit of a smoother relationship than what Berejiklian and Barilaro once had.
I'm really pleased to be elected as the leader of the New South Wales Nationals this morning. I'll have more to say very shortly, but I'll tell you what, I'm looking forward to getting back to work.
So that's Paul Toole there, the new Deputy Premier, and we will see him go down to Government House later this afternoon to be officially sworn in. It's been a big week, a lot of turmoil and a lot of change on Macquarie Street. Lizzie, a new Premier and a new Deputy, and the old Premier coming out to say thank you.
It is all happening. Liz Daniels there for us. Four school students who sat the general achievement test in Melbourne have tested positive to COVID, as Victoria records another 1,420 cases. Christina Hearn reports.
Well, the AMA says it's going to be increasingly hard to find ICU beds in Victoria as the case numbers continue to climb. Despite this, the Victorian Premier says we will be reopening as scheduled at the end of the month. But a real test to the roadmap will be our schools, because already we have had positive cases, even though Melbourne schools only opened yesterday for Year 12s to sit their general achievement test. The government has confirmed there are now four positive cases, and that includes one at Roxburgh College. We have also had a real insight into just what our frontline workers are facing from the head of the ICU unit at the Austin Hospital.
Some patients who have become so desperately unwell and they're actually dying that we've had to put a patient on a heart-lung machine over the weekend.
Doctors have warned people not to wait to get vaccinated. They said COVID will be everywhere in Victoria. And I'm here at a Brunswick clinic dubbed the Tropical Wonderland Vaccination Clinic. They've themed it tropical to give people a reason to what to look forward to. And we can see someone getting vaccinated there as Victoria tries to get their vaccination rate up to that 70% milestone.
New South Wales has recorded 594 new COVID cases in the past 24 hours and, sadly, 10 more deaths. It's the lowest number of new infections the state has recorded since August 17. It is a positive sign heading towards Freedom Day. New Premier Dominic Perrottet will meet with health officials today to discuss potential changes to the state's roadmap. to Queensland, where no new local cases of COVID have been detected overnight. It comes as the Sunshine State ramps up its vaccination push. Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk calling for people living in Ipswich, Logan, Beaudesert and the Sunshine Coast to come forward for their vaccines. 48.89% of Queenslanders are now fully vaccinated. Well, he spent 21 years in jail for some of the most horrific crimes Sydney has ever seen. Just hours ago, Mohammed Skaf walked from Long Bay Jail. Kelly Fedor was there. Kelly, the 38-year-old has been slapped with a number of tough parole conditions.
That's right, Lizzie, very strict conditions, but out for the first time in more than two decades. Mohammed Skaf wore a Hugo Boss jumper and dark sunglasses for that big moment. Walking from Long Bay Prison here with community corrections officers who escorted him down to a waiting car and drove him back into a community that is very different from the one that he left as a teenager all those years ago. He was driven straight back to the family home, a reunion there behind closed doors with the family members who have stood by him throughout that whole period. He was jailed for his role in the terrifying rapes which terrorised Sydney in the lead up to the 2000 Olympics. But the State Parole Authority granted him parole not long ago because it basically said there was no other option. With 2 years remaining on his maximum sentence, they had to release him now, so there was some supervision because at the end of his maximum sentence, of course, there's no supervision at all. And this is expected to be a difficult reintegration into the community for Mohammed Skaf. He will be subject to strict conditions. They include 24-hour electronic monitoring. There's a ban on entering some parts of Sydney. And he also cannot contact his brother, Bilal Skaf, who he committed those crimes with. There are, though, still concerns despite those stringent conditions. And today the police minister warned him not to put a foot wrong. Lizzie?
Kelly Fedor reporting there. Former Prime Minister Tony Abbott has arrived in Taiwan amid rising tensions with China. Let's go live to federal politics reporter Jonathan Kersley in Canberra. Jono, somewhat of a surprise visit. Why is he there?
Good morning, Lizzie. Tony Abbott was greeted by a government official last night ahead of meetings with the President and the Foreign Minister of Taiwan. He's there in a private capacity to address a regional forum later this week. He's not representing the government formally, but the timing with this is interesting. China was criticised by Taiwan earlier this week after Beijing sent dozens of warplanes into Taiwanese airspace over 4 days. That prompted Taiwan to scramble its own military aircraft in a region that is a potential flashpoint. Taiwan is an independent democracy, but it has long been claimed by China. Earlier this week, Taiwan's foreign minister told the ABC the self-ruled island is preparing for war with China and it wants Australia's assistance to increase intelligence sharing. China's increasingly become more aggressive towards Taiwan. In July, Xi Jinping pledged to reunite Taiwan and China.
I don't see a conflict of that nature in the short term. What there is a really high risk of is some kind of an accident. When you have this many planes in the air, when you have this many Taiwanese fighters responding, there's such a good chance of miscalculation and things going south.
China's aggressiveness is not just restricted to Taiwan. Experts say it's throughout the South China Sea. Malaysia has just called in China's ambassador to protest what it says are the activities of Chinese ships, including a spy ship. Indonesia has also recently detected Chinese ships near its island and intensified patrols there. This is an issue both sides of politics in Australia are going to have to contend with. Anthony Albanese was asked about this earlier today.
There's a bipartisan commitment to a one China policy. And that's bipartisan. It's been there for a long period of time. And Australia should continue to urge for peaceful actions in our region.
Lizzie, that is something the vast majority hope for, but in life and in politics, nothing is guaranteed.
You are right. Jono Kersley there in Canberra.